Hello, welcome to the Avenue. It's so good to see you. It's a beautiful day. Let's stand together. We'll sing. When darkness tries to roll over my bones, and sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, oh, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance.
This is amazing grace. Proceeded by God, you are so good. And God, right now, there's so many in this room and watching online that are just exhausted, ready to quit. But God, we hold on to that truth that you are doing a new thing. Our hope isn't in a career or a relationship or even a political party, but our hope is found in you, and we hold on to that today. God, you are so worthy of our worship today. I pray this in your son's name. Amen. You can have a seat. If you've got a sixth grader through 12th grader, big weekend is sneaking up on us. We're excited to announce that we are headed to Sky Ranch in Van, Texas. Listen, we only have a limited number of spots, so jump on and sign up today. December the 3rd, the price will go up. If you don't know anything about Big Weekend, it is a life-changing weekend for your students. So jump on today before we run out of spots. This year, we partnered up with a ministry out of the Rio Grande Valley to go and distribute food to those in need. We've sent two teams already. We're sending another team next week. And I want you to hear this. If you know that God has called you to do something or called you to act, don't put it off. There are still spots available to go next week. In fact, at 12:30 right here in the community room, they're going to be getting together and talking through that week. And we want to invite you in on that if you want some more information. Because here's what we believe. We believe through missions, God not only does a work in the lives of those that we're serving, but we believe that God does a work in our hearts too. And so go check them out today, 12:30 in the community room over there. If you're a first-time guest, I want you to know that you're under no obligation today to join us on this journey of generosity. But if you're an Avenue owner, I want to encourage you to continue to give faithfully so that we can go on mission trips, so that we can make an impact here in our community. And there's a couple ways that you can do that. The first thing that you can do is text Avenue Give to the number 77977. Or as you head out today, drop your offering in the offering box in the back, whatever is easiest for you. We are on week 3 of our series, We Are. God has got something special for you today. Y'all lean in.
Good morning. Those of you that are in the room here in Waxahachie and online, did you notice that Chad Rogers has lost about 70 pounds in the past few weeks? Isn't that great? Right when I went into quarantine, I decided I wanted to be healthier. And so I really spent a lot of time eating clean and exercising. When I got back in the office, I wanted to lead our guys to be healthier. And there's several people have been going through this, but three of them in particular that you'll see around the Avenue have lost 70 pounds apiece. And so they've done a great job, incredible. Want to be healthy. We want Chad healthy. He's got four beautiful children, and he needs to be healthy for them. And so we're going to be talking about that today, a little bit about father's responsibility. But I just want you to know, those of you in Ennis, all the Ennis staff skinny, so there's nothing we can do there. They're all younger than we are, so they're doing great. But thank you for joining us today. We've been in the book of Ephesians, I know some of you think, for a long time. But we're coming to the end of it. We're coming to chapter 6, and I just wanted to kind of begin to talk to you today and remind you that in the first three chapters of the book of Ephesus, the letter to Ephesus, is talking about our identity in Jesus. So three chapters are talking about who Jesus is and what he did for us, how he created a new identity. And those of us that are in Christ, which means those of us have given our life to follow him. Those of us have said, please forgive my sins and I want to be like you. He begins to give us the power to change our life. And so Paul writes and says, this is who you are in Christ. And now because of that, your behavior, your attitude, your actions are going to change. Let me give you some examples. So for the past few weeks, we've been going through some of those examples, and today we're going to land on the primary example of what changes in our life when we're in Christ. The primary thing that changes in our life when we become a follower of Jesus is our family. Family is the just the hinchpin of everything Jesus does. In fact, if you read throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament, God is always bringing family together. He gives us a picture of marriage. He gives us a picture of the family of God, and he talks about family, family, family. In chapter 5, it talks about man and woman marriage, that marriage relationship and how it's a mystery and how that's how Jesus responds to the church. And I'm telling you, in chapter 5, men, he speaks to us in an incredibly difficult situation. Marriage, this thing that we do, this thing that brings us together, this thing that causes more grief than anything else in your life. He gives the women a responsibility. He says, I want you to respect your husband. And that's great. And then he looks at you and says, but I want you to love your wife. And that love is not just, you know, I like her a lot. It's a love that is sacrificing. He says, I want you to love her like Jesus loves the church, which means he gives himself for her. He gives himself up for her. He meets her needs above his. Love requires him to be the stronger spouse in order to just make this marriage what it needs to be. A lot of responsibility. In chapter 6, he takes that responsibility and he passes it on to how you father your children. And so I've said before, and I want you to hear, you're responsible for your family if you're a man listening today. You are spiritually responsible to lead this family. And I know a lot of you, you'd much rather the wife lead because she's more spiritual than you. I get it. Your wife's smarter than you too, but you still have some say. And so he says, I want you to lead spiritually. That means if Jesus knocked on your door this afternoon to inquire about the spiritual health of your family, he's not going to interview your wife. He's not going to talk to your children. He's going to take you aside, sit you down, and say, how are you doing with my family? How are you leading my family? Are you loving my daughter the way that you're supposed to love her? Are you taking care of those blessings that I've given you the way you're supposed to take care of those blessings? How are you doing, Dad? Listen, everything hinges on that father's responsibility in the family, and it is a very difficult spot to be in. And I know some of you right now, you're thinking, I picked the wrong week to come back to church. Some of you online have already turned it off. We're going to see the numbers just drop. I understand. There's a lot of responsibility, but I want you to know most of the problems we have in our world today is because of the absence of the father figure in our life. When I say father to many of you, it brings a smile to your face. You think of great things. You think about your father. But most of you in the room think about pain because father has hurt you in one way or another. Do you know that most children born to women under 30 now are born out of wedlock? Most children born to women under 30 are born out of wedlock. Most children go to bed at night now in the United States without the biological father in the house. And so it's difficult. And so when we stand here today and I begin to talk about fathers and families, immediately some of you are going to feel overwhelmed. But I want you to understand, as I tell you today, I'm not standing as an expert. I'm not standing as, watch me, I got it right. I did more things wrong than I can imagine. And if your personality is like mine, you only remember the things you did wrong. You never remember the things you did right. I don't lay in bed at night going, man, I really did a good job on that one. I really was great there. Man, I really stepped up. I usually lay in bed and think about the things I should have done and wish I'd have done. I look at pictures in the past, and I don't think about the happy times. I think about the times I blew it. So if you're there today, I want you to hear really quickly that there's grace in all of this, and God loves you, and he is a good father to you. And the things I'm asking you to do as a father, he does toward you. So when he looks at you, he doesn't see all of your failures. He sees the things you got right, and he wants to encourage you, and I want to encourage you today. It starts in that marriage, and in the avenue, we make marriage a priority. We talk about it all the time. We push it. We want you to have a great marriage. Every marriage is hard, and so we've set up things called Reengage, which is a 16-week intensive study that you do with your spouse. And you think you don't have problems. Wait till you start going through that 16 weeks. You realize quickly, I thought we had a good marriage. You don't. And so you go through this, and if you can make it through 16 weeks, you're closer at the end of it. We had 130 people just went on a retreat for the weekend and spent a couple days with a facilitator teaching them how to communicate and how to have conversations in marriage. Because one of the things we found out through this quarantine is a lot of you have been social distancing long before we had any kind of coronavirus. And all of a sudden, the social distance in families kind of disappeared. And it's hard to go through everything we've gone through the last year if you're living with somebody you really don't like, right? And some of you have been experiencing that. So we've gotten lots of calls and lots of counseling dealing with marriages that are have been in bad shape for a long time. They're just now realizing it. So there's a lot of responsibility for the father. But then it shifts and it gives a responsibility to being a father, not just being a husband, but loving your children. So what I want to do right now, before we get cranking up in it, is if you're a father today, in us, online, here in the room, even front porch, I want you just to stand if you're a father. All of the men in the room that are fathers, please stand. And as we stand, I want you to stay standing for a minute because I want you to understand something about this. There's grace today. But just because there's grace doesn't mean we shouldn't strive to be the men God's called us to be. If we can be the committed fathers that God has called us to be, if we can step up right now and do the things God has called us to do, we can change a generation. I'm a father. I'm a father to 5 kids. And so I ask you the same question I ask myself. Are you a good father? Are you a good father? Are you a bad father? Are you taking responsibility for your family, or have you given up responsibility to somebody else? Would your children consider you a blessing or a burden? How about your wife? Does she see you as a gift? Is she glad to have you, or is she grieved by you? In the afternoon when the garage door goes up, do your children run and hide? Does your wife have a sense of dread? Or is she excited? Are they glad that dad's home? Do you have daughters? They're going to get married one day. Sorry that depressed some of you. Do you want them to marry a man like you? Because they will. Do you have sons? Do you want to grow them to grow up to be the men that you are? If you answered any of these questions, then there's a grief in your heart. Now, hopefully you heard some of this and you're excited. You accept the responsibility. You're ready. Come on, give me what I got to do. I'm excited. But I know a majority of you heard that and went, ugh, I wish I wasn't here today. There's grace. I want to pray over you. Father, I thank you for these men. I thank you for the role you've given them, the responsibility. Help us all step into that, to understand that, to not question it, to be the men that you've called us to be, to lead our families, to lead our wives, and to lead our children. God, look, we want to do it the way you want it done. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, go and be seated. Chapter 6 starts, and it starts with children. Children, obey your parents. Children, and listen, it'd be a lot easier to be a parent if your children would what? Obey you. That'd make everything a lot easier. But you have to understand, we are only 20 years from a heathen pagan generation. These kids come out heathens. They come out totally opposed to God, and you know that. Now, only people in this room that think that toddlers are cute are people who've not had toddlers. Because they may do some cute things, but they are savages. Let's be honest. If an 18-month-old had the power to kill you, you'd be dead. You take that cookie away from an 18-month-old. If they could wield a knife, you would be cut up pretty badly. Because that's just the way they are. They are all pagans, heathens, and we have just a short time to try to train them and try to teach them what it means to be a decent person first, and then second, a child of God. And so children, it says to obey your parents. Now, I want you to understand something. This word children means children. Some of you have an overbearing mom who's raised in a religious home, and you're like 40, and they're still quoting this. That does not apply to you. As a grown adult, you do not have to obey your parents anymore. You do not have to obey them. That is not part of the plan. Now, you live at home under their care. I don't care if you're 14 or 30. You're a child. If your parents are supporting you, if you're underneath their roof, you are still a child, and this verse applies. But once you move out, ladies and gentlemen, you do not have to obey your parents anymore. So you're like, phew, that's a relief. But you have to honor them. See, obey and honor are two different things. Honor is deeper than obey. I remember I saw a little cartoon of a little toddler. His mom put him in time out and said, I want you to go sit in that corner. And he said, I may be sitting on the outside, but I'm standing on the inside. And I thought, isn't that most of us? There's a difference in obeying and honoring. And as an adult, we are to honor our parents all times. And the way to honor your parent is to listen. I know some of you people, you have one life to live. It's going to be your oldest child. I get it. But that's not the way it works. You need to honor your parents by listening. You don't have to obey. You have to honor your parents by respecting them, but you don't have to obey. If you're living in the home, you have no choice. I love when somebody comes and tells me, I'm an adult, I can do what I want. Pay your bills. That's the first step in doing what you want. Be an adult. Most time if a teenager tells me they're an adult, it's pretty clear they're not an adult yet. You don't have to define it. So if you're a child at home, you obey. Outside the home, you honor. You do these things. And this is what it says. It says, as you honor your parents, you will have a long life. First commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you and you may enjoy a long life. That's the only place it says you'll have a long life if we obey and honor our parents. And so that applies to all of us today. Now, the problem is, once again, that father figure. Many of you have been wounded by the father, whether he was absent, whether he was there, whether he was neglectful, whether he was abusive. And so when I talk about the father, you have all these different emotions that flood your mind. And so I want you to see, first of all, how God speaks about the father and what he wants us to do as men. First thing he says is, fathers, do not exasperate. Do not exasperate your children. Do not provoke your children. Do not anger your children. The best word I found in this is, do not frustrate your children. The Bible calls us to love our kids and to train them and to help them grow. But a lot of times the father becomes a source of frustration because he's never satisfied. He's always complaining. He's always critiquing. He's not giving the love and the compassion and the care. He's there always as a symbol of what I've done wrong instead of what I've done right. And so God very quickly says, hey, I want you not to provoke your children. I want you to train them. I want you to encourage them. I want you to bring them up in instruction. Don't provoke them. How do we provoke our children? Well, if you've ever done a marriage seminar, you've heard something called a love bank. A love bank is things in our life that people do to make us feel loved. And in marriage, we talk about this a lot. We talk about the things that make us feel loved, quality time, affirmation. We talk about, you know, physical touch. We talk about gifts and acts of service. All of those are how we get deposits into this love bank. Your children also have a love bank. And every one of your children have a different thing that deposits into them. All five of my children, they have different love language. And I have to know each child. I can do the same thing, but only one of them may feel loved in that way. And so you've got to learn, what do your children need to feel love? Some of them, it's just words of affirmation. Just tell them they're doing a good job. Do you know even your adult children want to hear that their parents are proud of them? So if many of them, you speak words of affirmation to them. For some of them, it's physical touch. It's cuddling. It's hugging. I have a little granddaughter. I was at her their ranch this weekend, and we were riding on a little gator. And all of a sudden, she pulled my arm up to put it across the seat so she could lay her head in the corner of my arm and just hug my arm. She loves to cuddle. I've got other grandchildren that if I tried to cuddle them, they would beat me up. They don't want cuddling. They want something different. And so as a father, we learn how to love our children the way they want to be loved. Because in every family, there's going to be some withdrawals. And I wish I could tell you today that, man, just live for God and you're going to have a perfect family and you're never going to make a mistake. You're not going to do anything wrong. But that's not true, man. You're going to make a withdrawal. Something is going to happen. You're going to be tired. You're going to be worn out. You're going to have something go wrong at work. You're going to be fighting with your wife. You're going to say something in that child's life that hurts them. That's just the nature of it. And I wish it wasn't, but it's the nature of it. The thing with you is you need to have more deposits than you do withdrawals. And many of you in this room are making withdrawals without deposits. And that provokes your children. That gets them into a situation where they feel helpless and hopeless. For some of you, you make withdrawals with physical abuse. You're too physical with your children. You respond in anger physically, and that is never correct with a child. Never correct with a child. I don't say that there can't be discipline with a child that's physical. I'm not saying that. There can be no physical contact out of anger. It has to be out of love. I can tell you, I got a lot of things wrong, but this is an area that I worked on and made sure I didn't. My children, if they were corrected for their future best, not their punishment for the past. I never snatched the kids up in anger. Always disciplining in love. Some of you men are too physical with your kids, and you need to watch yourself because it's more about you than what they did. So be careful with that. Be very careful. Do you realize you have a strength and you are frightening to a child? And if you like frightening a child, you need some help. I'll just tell you that quickly. So don't be so physical with your children. And then equal to that is verbal abuse. Now, I wish I could say I perfected this, but I have a very sharp tongue, and I know I hurt my children verbally. I know I said things that I regret to this day. And like I told you, you know, Satan always reminds me of the things I did wrong. I always hear those echo in my heart, and there's nothing I can do to take them back. So I want to encourage you to be careful with your words and to bring words of life, words of love to your children, not words that bring them down and hurt them. You may say something that you didn't mean the way you said it, but they'll hold on to it, and it'll have a huge impact in their life. I've told you about my dad and how great a man he was, and he was. He was a wonderful man. This is a man that would tuck me in bed every night, even as a teenager, and say things like, guess what, I love you, how much, heaps and heaps and heaps. Every night he would do this, and he would bring me to bed and pray with me. He was an incredible dad. There was one trip we took to the Grand Canyon. Now, I don't know why an ideal family vacation is getting in a car and driving for days, because that turns into a nightmare, right? My dad was having a particularly bad day. I don't know what was wrong. I don't know what had happened. I'm sure we were driving him nuts. And I remember my mom said something like, well, why did you even have kids? And he said, I don't know. Well, I held on to that as an 8-9-year-old kid. Now, here's a man who did everything to show me his love. But that one statement, I can remember today. I remember the car. I remember where we were. And I remember that he said it. Now, that would break his heart to know that that's one of the things he said that I held on to after all the positive things. But it reminds me of how important our words are in our children's life. And so some of you, you need to guard your mouth. For some of you, you make withdrawals because you're emotionally absent. When I say emotionally absent, I don't care if you're there in body. You need to be there in spirit and mind. Some of you think, oh, I'm doing great. My son's in the room with me while you're on your phone. Oh, we're having dinner together at a restaurant, and you're watching the game over their shoulder. Folks, you need to be present with your kids. And let me remind you, as an old man, and I know you're not going to hear me, but it's true. Kids grow up like that. I know when you're living in the moment, you think it lasts forever, especially with toddlers. You got to be kidding me. This has lasted for 37 years. I'm dying. I get it. But as an old man, looking back over the years that I raised children, it is in an instant that they are grown. So be present with them. When they're there, be with them. Be involved with them. Turn the TV off. Turn the computer off. Spend time listening to them. Just pay attention to what they're doing. And don't be so emotionally absent in their life. Show them that they're the most important thing in your world. Give them your attention. Here's a great way to play that out today. When you walk out of here and you pick up your child and you're having an adult conversation and that child is tugging and wants to tell you something. I know you're trying to teach them to be quiet when adults are talking. But let me tell you, let me give you something else. Why don't you stop the adult conversation for 1 second? Get down on their level and just say, what is it you need? Can you imagine what that would do? That shows them they're more important than this adult conversation. Listen, I'd rather stop the adult conversation and spend that second with my child. If you see me around the avenue with my grandchildren, don't come talk to me because I'm going to ignore you. Well, that's rude. I'm not trying to be your hero. I'm trying to be their hero. So next time you're having an adult conversation and they tug on you, just take a second to show them you're the they're the most important person to you at that moment. Emotionally be present. You got to be careful with public criticism. Listen, our kids' egos are fragile, and when they're in public and around their friends, you may think it's funny to say something about whatever's going on in their life or make a joke that you think is funny, but it is devastating to the children. Do not ever publicly criticize your child. Do not point out their flaws in front of their friends. As far as their friends know, they need to think they're as perfect as possible. Some of you men that are coaching, I'm going to encourage you, stop. Stop coaching. You're not emotionally mature enough to handle it. That sounds hard, doesn't it? But you can't criticize your child. I'm trying to make him the best player I can be. He's not going to be. Leave him alone. Treat him the same way you treat those other kids on that team. Don't expect more out of him because he's your son. Who cares if he's your son? Love him. Encourage him. Don't publicly criticize that boy on that baseball field. Now, I'm going to get associations today calling. We don't have any coaches left. I get it. I'm not saying you can't coach. I'm saying just be extra careful when you do coach not to expect more from your child than anybody else because he's just 8. You get me? This is not a sermon. I get a lot of amens. I don't know why. A lot of you women are amening, but you're keeping it quiet because you're scared. I get it. But man, don't criticize your children in public. Some of you men are too serious too. Some of you men are way too serious. You need to have a good time. You need to have fun with your kids. You need to be silly with your kids. You need to enjoy them. You don't have to always be teaching them some valuable lesson. Just enjoy your children. Have fun with them. Play with them. Play make-believe with them. Have a good time with them. And be generous. Oh, I want to teach my kid the value of a dollar. They'll learn it. You got a dollar? Buy them a snack. Just be generous. Stop trying to prove everything. Well, I had to work with... No, you didn't. Somebody in your life was generous to you. And you remember them. Didn't you love the grandfather that pulled out the change and just let you take all you wanted? Those are your favorite people. The granddad that bought you ice cream? That's who we remember. So stop being so stingy with your kids. Be generous. And then a big one, guys. Kids know you blow it. One of the best things you can do is to look at them and say, I messed up. Hey, I lost my temper. Hey, I said something I shouldn't have. Hey, I didn't treat your mom right. I'm sorry that you saw that. I need to do better. Just willingly admit fault. How do we model the right behavior? God gives us a long list. These are the things you can do wrong. Now let me tell you what you can do right. First thing you can do to be the father you need to be is love your wife. Isn't that strange? The best father you can be loves their wife, is compassionate to their wife, is considerate to their wife. And the boys see how you treat that woman, and the girls see how you treat that woman. And that's why I ask you, do you want your girls to marry a man like you? Do you want them to marry a man like you? Because that's what they're going to do. So you better learn how to treat your wife in front of that daughter so they know the correct way to be treated. Treat them the right way. Men, treat your wives. Love your wives. The best thing you can do for your children's security, for their stability, is to show the love that you have. Every time you hug your wife and kiss her, your kids are going to say, ooh, gross. Because it is. But it does something for them. It does something for them. Do you know most of your kids live with the fear that you're going to divorce? They live in that fear. So love your wife. Practice godliness. Let the kids see godliness in action. Instead of being drug out of bed to come to church because your wife is screaming at you, get up first and lead them to the church. Tell them how important it is. Show them how important it is in your life that, well, I'm going to church no matter what else comes up. If something better comes up, I'm still going to go to church. Lead them in that. Let them catch you reading the Bible. Let them see you pray. And then always be teaching. Always be teaching. In Deuteronomy 6, it says, as we go, listen, there's a lot of responsibility to fathers, but it does some incredible things to us. The first thing it does to a man, it expands our heart. It expands your heart. I didn't realize how much capability I had of loving until I became a father. I remember that first child came out. I had a little girl, and she wrecked me. I didn't know you could love anybody like I loved that little girl. It was incredible how much I loved her. And then like 9 months later, we found out we're having another baby. And I was a little nervous. I really was, because I'm like, this is not going to be fair. I can't love the second one like I love this one. I hope that second one never knows how much I love this one compared until she was born. And what happened when she was born? My heart doubled, apparently, because I loved them both. And then I had 3 and 4 and 5, and my heart grew and grew and grew. And then I had grandchildren, and it freaking exploded. I can't believe how much love we're capable of, and having children shows us how much we are capable of loving something else other than ourselves. It's incredible. Being a father also expands our interest. When I was young, I liked the things I liked. You know, I liked football. I liked baseball. I like to hunt. I watched all those things. I enjoyed those things. And then all of a sudden, I had 2 girls. And I'm going to gymnastics meets. And I'm catching myself yelling things like, stick it. What does that even mean? Then they went to cheerleading. 4 hours of sitting for 2.5 minutes. But I was cheering. Land it. Whatever. And then my boys started getting me involved in things that I would have never believed. I mean, I actually fell in love with a communist sport. Have y'all heard of soccer? I mean, you didn't play soccer. You don't even use your hands. What stupid is that? And you play in the rain, and you're in shorts, and in Texas, we put it right in the middle of winter. Never been colder than watching soccer in my entire life. But you know what? Today, I'd rather watch a World Cup than the World Series. Now, my dad's not around. He wouldn't be disappointed in me to hear that. But I love soccer. Why? Because my children did it. It expands our world incredibly. And then for me, it expanded my prayer life like you wouldn't believe. When my children were born, I prayed for their safety. I prayed for wisdom. I prayed for patience. I prayed for their future spouses. When they became teenagers, I prayed for my sanity. When I gave them the keys to the car, I prayed for their safety and prayed for peace. When they went to college, I prayed I'd win the lottery. It changed my prayer life. And being a good husband and a good father is the hardest job you'll ever have. And I know a lot of you come to church and you go, man, I failed. I get it. But you know, you can succeed. Today is about today. Don't let Satan hold your past over you. Don't let Satan point out all the times you failed. Today, I want to be the best husband and the best father I can be moving forward. And that's what I'm challenging you to do, because God has given you a lot of responsibilities. And I know a lot of you have not had good examples. My generation grew up and every father you saw on TV was an idiot, buffoon. The wife took care of the family. The man was just a problem to be laughed at. That's not the way God intends it. God intends for men to lead out and take responsibility for their family. A father is to love and care for their children. The Bible says, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. Our compassion in our children are time investments, time with our kids. They grow up quickly. Spend time with your kids. Be engaged. Find those teachable moments. Sit with them. Love them. Care for them. Discipline your children. Father's responsibility is to discipline children. A father is the one that carries out discipline in the family. So the mother is the nurturer. Listen, it goes against the mother's nature to discipline. She wants to always nurture. That man is to discipline those children and not give that over. It says if you spare the rod, you spoil that child. You're to instruct your children. How do you instruct them? You lead your family spiritually. You lead them spiritually. For some of you, that's the hardest step. You bring them to church, but to lead them spiritually is to sit down at the dinner table and explain why you pray. It's to tuck them in bed at night and pray over them and pray for them. It's to love your wife and to pray for her. We see this all the way through. God says, I want you to lead. Like I said, if this afternoon Jesus came to your door, he'd sit down with you. I know that terrifies some of you. Because today he may put his arm around you and go, man, you need to step up. But isn't it great that we serve a good father who treats us the way we're to treat our children? And so when we mess up, he puts his arms around us and he says, we can do better. I can do better through you if you just let me. I want you to lead your family spiritually. I want you to follow me so they can follow you. You're to provide for your family. You're to get the bills paid. You're to work. You're to do the things to provide for them, to give them security, to give them safety. You're to put them first in everything. That's not easy. That's what we're called to do. When I had 5 kids growing up in a full-time job, I didn't have time for a hobby. They were my hobby. That's all I had time for. Some of you men, you need to provide and you need to protect your family. You need to protect your family. Now, those of you out there that are living in a single family right now, some of you mothers who something's happened in that marriage or you haven't been married, you hear this and you think, oh, I'm lost. What am I going to do? You're not lost. Because God is the father in those families. God says, I will be the father to the fatherless. I'll be the husband to the widow, to those without. I will be that person. So today, any family and every family here. You have God to fill that role. Some of you are in step families, and you're fortunate that the step in that family has stepped into that role to be that godly influence in your life. So today, what's keeping you from being the man, the father, the husband you need to be? For some of you, let's be honest, it's salvation. You can't do this without Jesus. You can't live the Bible. See, I have a lot of people say, I'm going to try to live by the Bible to be a better person. That's impossible. Living by the Bible is impossible without Jesus Christ. I can't be the husband and father I need to be without Jesus. I can promise you that. I am selfish. I am greedy. I want my own way. The only thing that makes us good is Him. So some of you need salvation. For some of you, it's knowledge. You just need to hear these things. You need to know them. You're watching culture, and culture's never going to lead you in the right direction. For some of you, it's accountability. That's why we have Fight Club. So you can gather with other men and sit with them and hold each other accountable. We don't want our wives holding us accountable, do you? I don't even want my wife holding me accountable on a diet. You supposed to eat that? I'll eat anything I want. I'm tired of being in shape. I want to be fat again. Leave me alone. You need accountability. So I encourage you to gather some men around you. For some of you, you just need an example. I have the best example for everyone in this room. The Bible says you have a good, good Father. You have a holy God who loves you, who cares for you, who leads you spiritually, who provides for you, who protects, who does everything a father does. Just be like Him. And when you go home today, ask yourself a question. What does my wife, what does love require me to do with my wife today? What does love require me to do with my children today? God, how can I lead as I follow You? Let me pray over you. Father God, thank You for the privilege. We thank You for You being the example of a good father. Now, God, help those in the room to be like You. Help the men in this room, the men listening online, the men in this campus, rise up, step up, and be the men they need to be so we can see a change in our culture, a change in our community, and let it start here at the Avenue Church. Thank You for Your forgiveness where we failed You, but today's a new day in You. Help us to walk in a manner worthy. In Jesus' name.
Stories in world, think you're lying, but I've a tender whisper of love, the dead of night and you tell that you're pleasing the night, never alone. You're a good, good father.
If you are a first-time guest, we are just so pumped that you join us. We've got a special gift for you out in the commons at the Hub, just as a way to say thank you for joining us today. Everyone else, it's always good to see most of your face. Y'all have an incredible week. We'll see you next Sunday. Take care.